¿Qué tal? Yo soy Enrique Acevedo desde la Casa Blanca en Washington, D.C.
Por primera vez, un medio hispano pasó 3 días con el presidente de Estados Unidos. Televisa Univision acompañó a Joe Biden en giras de campaña y en su trabajo en la Casa Blanca. Nuestro encuentro empezó en Las Vegas, Nevada, en donde el presidente Biden se reunió con miembros de la comunidad hispana para compartir sus propuestas sobre vivienda de bajo costo. En el auditorio estaban Víctor Cureño, de 51 años, quien junto con María, su esposa, acaban de comprar su primera casa con asistencia federal.
We're the United States of America. There is nothing beyond our capacity when we work together. We're the only nation in the world that's come out of every crisis stronger than we went in.
Poco después, el presidente abordó el Air Force One para dirigirse a Phoenix, Arizona, un estado fronterizo que fue decisivo para darle el triunfo en 2020 y que este año también será determinante en la balanza electoral.
You know, wait, last time, you're the reason why, in large part, I beat Donald Trump. Yes. Let's beat him again.
Ahí sostuvo que la educación en ciencia y tecnología es el camino para lograr empleos sostenibles y bien pagados. Días después nos volvimos a encontrar en el Salón Roosevelt de la Casa Blanca para sostener una conversación que ustedes podrán ver hoy. Como parte de este encuentro, acompañamos al presidente Biden a la Oficina Oval, el despacho de todos los mandatarios estadounidenses desde 1909. Ahí habló de su familia y del legado que espera dejarle al país.
This is the night we became president and vice president. Okay?
That's Chicago.
This is the Chicago. Mm-hmm. That was my mom. And look at the look in his face.
Mientras conversamos con el presidente, evolucionaba en las Cortes el proceso judicial de su oponente, el expresidente Donald Trump. Continuaba la llegada de migrantes de distintas nacionalidades a la frontera con México y en el Medio Oriente un ataque israelí con misiles terminó con la vida de 7 activistas humanitarios de la World Central Kitchen, la organización del chef José Andrés, que buscaba llevar comida a los habitantes de Gaza. De este y otros temas hablaremos con Joe Biden, la entrevista.
In your State of the Union address, you said freedom and democracy are under assault at home, drawing parallels to crucial points in history like the Civil War and FDR's wartime leadership. What, in your view, constitutes the primary threat to freedom and democracy at home?
Donald Trump. Seriously. Donald Trump uses phrases like you're going to eviscerate the Constitution, he's going to be a dictator on day one. The idea that he would sit in the office, and I'll show you before you leave, off the Oval Office, and watch for hours the attack on the Capitol and the destruction and the mayhem and the people who were killed, the police officers who died, and call them political heroes, call them patriots, and saying that if he gets elected, he's going to free them all because they're being held illegally. I mean, it's just, and think of the things he says. Look at the way he talks about minority populations, Hispanics, you know, we're talking about them being, anyway, I can't think of any other time in my lifetime, in history that's occurred, that you've had somebody who's had this kind of attitude. He says, I'm gonna be a dictator on day one. No one doesn't believe him.
This is the first rematch election in almost 70 years, but it is the first time in history that one of the candidates is facing federal charges for his alleged efforts to overturn the result of the 2020 election and disrupt the certification of the electoral vote on January 6. How is that shaping the way you are running your campaign?
Well, look, we all know who Donald Trump is. I mean, Donald Trump from even before the election was calling it, they're going to be, he talked about they're going to be cheating and all this. And all the times they took these cases to the Supreme Court of the United States, Republican court, a very conservative court, and said, no, there isn't any. I mean, but he is, you can't love your country only when you win. And his attitude about what he should be able to be doing and what the power of presidency is. He wants to suspend parts of the Constitution. Who in God's name would say that? Who has said that before? So he has a very, I think, jaded view of the Constitution. He made it clear that he doesn't plan on abiding by parts of it if he thinks it's not appropriate. And it's just, at least he's saying it out loud.
And let me switch gears because gun violence remains the number one cause of death for children in America.
Absolutely.
Latinos have made it a top priority across the country, especially in places like El Paso and Uvalde. In Texas, your administration called on Congress to pass common sense gun laws, but that's unlikely to happen in the next few months. If you're reelected, would you consider taking further executive action on this issue?
Absolutely. Look, I, along with Dianne Feinstein, passed the first limitation on assault weapons mm-hmm. and the number of bullets that could be in a rifle. The idea anybody needs 100 rounds in a rifle and an AR-15. I was out in Uvalde. I met with every one of those families. I spent 4 hours with them. I look at the pain in their faces. I saw what they felt. I could feel it. And the idea that, and you know, his phrase on another context where there was a mass shooting, I think it was in El Paso, he said, they said, what to do? I said, just get over it. Got to get over it. The idea we don't have background checks for anybody purchasing a weapon. The idea that we're going to be in a position where he says that he famously told the NRA that don't worry, no one's going to touch your guns if I. From the very beginning, I used to teach the Second Amendment in law school. From the very beginning, there were limitations. You couldn't own a cannon. You couldn't. You could own a rifle, a gun, but there were
weapons
certain things
war.
You couldn't. But they weren't weapons of war. And we passed the first major gun legislation in over 30 years. When we've passed the law that we recently passed that outlaws weapons that are made that you can't trace and so on and so forth. But it's not enough. I think we have to do more. And I am absolutely committed. And I've asked the Congress, and if I get a Congress and get reelected, we're going to do it again. We're going to make sure we eliminate these weapons.
Ahora Joe Biden busca permanecer en la Casa Blanca 4 años más. Con la pandemia en su retrovisor y apoyado en los resultados de una economía pujante que le ha permitido avanzar en la creación de empleos, un mayor acceso a la educación y la disminución en los costos del cuidado médico. Históricamente, la comunidad hispana ha tenido la tasa de cobertura médica y el acceso a cuidado preventivo más bajo en el país. Desde la entrada en vigor de la Ley de Cuidado de Salud a Bajo Costo, conocida como Obamacare, el porcentaje de latinos sin seguro médico pasó de 40.2% a 24.5%. Al igual que su programa para condonar la deuda de millones de estudiantes y el combate a la falta de acceso a vivienda de bajo costo, Obamacare es un tema recurrente en los discursos de campaña del presidente Biden y en entrevistas como la que tuvimos con él en la Casa Blanca.
But guess what? The Republicans have tried to eliminate it 50 times.
And the Affordable Care Act.
The Affordable Care Act. No, they really, and they're, yeah. And Trump is totally opposed to it. Totally opposed to it. Guess what? You'd have millions of people not able to have insurance because they have a pre-existing condition. No insurance coming. This covers that. And by the way, it generates economic growth. I just can't fathom the things that Donald Trump says and believes about. But he'll stand in Mar-a-Lago and say to his friends, I know you're all wealthy. I know 20 of you guys are worth a hell of a lot of money. We're going to make sure we get you a tax cut. And they're all cheering. Well, guess what, man? It's about time they start paying their fair share.
You mentioned how it's become a burden for millions of Americans, given the disproportionate impact healthcare expenses have on Latinos and their higher propensity for diseases like diabetes. What specifically is your administration doing to try to help ease that burden?
That's a place where we made great progress. For years, I've been trying to take on big pharma that makes billions of dollars a year overcharging for prescriptions. For example, we're in a situation where If you got an Air Force One with me and told him pick any country in Europe that you want me to fly to, I'd take you. You take your prescription from the United States from a drugstore. You can walk down the street here. I can get you that same exact prescription filled for 40-60% less. And so what we finally was able to do, and I've been fighting for this for a long time, is say, here's the deal. Medicare pays for all those drugs that seniors need for whatever the reason. But for example, there's a higher propensity among Hispanics for diabetes and other things. Well, guess what? Instead of paying $400 a month for insulin, you only have to pay $35 a month now. Done. And what's done also will take effect in January of next year, is that no matter what your total bills are for prescription drugs, you'll never have to pay more than $2,000 a year.
A year.
Because some of these cancer drugs are $10,000-$15,000 bucks a year.
And they bankrupt the family.
And they bankrupt, but here's the deal. What my very right-wing friends don't understand is, by doing one of these things, we save the government billions of dollars. Just the passage of the first piece of this legislation over the next 10 years, by changing the amount of money that they can charge for insulin, it's going to save the government $160 billion. You hear me? Cut the deficit by $160 billion. Because that means instead of paying $400 bucks, the government's paying the drug company $35, but it's going to go beyond that. And I think not only will it not affect seniors, I'm determined to see to it in the second term that it affects every American. No American should be paying the prices they're paying. Everyone should be paying what the prices that other countries do set the price of the drug by negotiating. If they don't want to be able to provide their drug, then they don't have to do it. They have to do it. But if they want to provide the government to pay for them, then guess what? They got to have a reasonable price.
Student debt weighs heavily on millions of graduates. It's been reported that after a series of legal challenges, your administration is working on a new student loan forgiveness program that is using a different legal authority, a different legal strategy. To be implemented. Can you share some of the details of that plan and what you've achieved
so far?
Sure,
I can. Look, there are two plans that existed already. I didn't have to, but they were ignored. And when the Supreme Court ruled I couldn't forgive student debt across the board, they said that, so we looked and saw what was out there. There's a program that exists that if you, in fact, are engaged in public service, your debt can be forgiven after an X number of years if you've continued to work or continue to pay your monthly payments. Well, that's allowed me to literally forgive the debt of millions of people, several million people, because these are firefighters, school teachers, et cetera, people who are engaged in public service, already written into the law, and it's working. There's also another plan called the SAVE plan, people with limited incomes. If they, in fact, and it exists in the books, and I'm using it now and have been using it, and it'll have a profound impact on the Latino community. Because what happens is, if you're not, you only have to pay relative to what you're earning. So, for example, if you're earning only $20,000 a year, you don't have to pay anything back until you earn more money. If you're earning $150,000 a year, you pay back proportionally what your debt is. So it's have a profound impact on giving people a chance. And look, the idea I get criticized for trying to emphasize investment in education. How in God's name can we lead the world without having the best education in the world? And as I said to you maybe before we started, I don't remember how I said it when we started, is that you got roughly 25 students from K through 12 out in every single class, 25 out of 100 students come from Spanish-speaking homes. How in God's name can we ignore that? It's our future. It's our future.
Especially in school districts like California and Texas.
Across the board, even my state of Delaware. Mm-hmm. And you also have a situation where, if you think about it, you have an enormous amount of involvement, investment, and all the studies have shown that if you come from a home where there's not books in the home, where parents are having difficulty where there may be a dislocation in the family. Those students are going to start off kindergarten having heard a million fewer words spoken. Not different, a million, they're not engaged. But if in fact they start preschool at age 3 and 4, they increase by 50% the prospects, nothing else, no matter what home they come from.
So access, early access.
Early access. And that's why I also put in $14 billion in Spanish-speaking institutions of higher education. And the reason for that is I did that same with the African Americans community, HBCUs, two separate funds. But here's the deal. Think about this. Every student who graduates from high school going to community college or college, whether they're Latino, Asian American, whatever, they have the same capacity as white students. But guess what? The universities don't have these large funds. And guess what? All the jobs of the future, what are they? They're high-tech jobs. They don't have laboratories to be trained in. So it's overwhelmingly the interest not only of the community, but the country, to grow the capacity for these students to be able to learn. So that's why I've invested in early education. And we have to do more than we're doing now. And it grows the economy. It costs money, but it generates significant growth.
Another issue that impacts not just Latino families, but families across the country is housing affordability.
That's right.
In Nevada, during your recent trip to Nevada and Phoenix, we spoke with Victor and Maria Cureno. They bought their first home at 51, thanks to a loan from the federal government that allowed them to put the down payment for their first house. So how would the new Biden-Harris administration make homeownership more attainable for families across the country, across the board?
Well, first of all, if you're buying your first home and or you're moving up from a small home to a larger home, we provide for the ability for you to essentially get a $10,000 payment to buy the first home and or to move to another home because of interest rates and the like. What that does is, again, that grows the economy. It allows people, and we've provided for millions of new homes, rental assistance. We sent people checks for a lot of money to subsidize their rent. Because it's, again, overwhelming the interest of the country that we do that. And so we have a major housing program through the Department of Health of Housing and Urban Development. We have a major program that through the legislation that no Republican voted for, I might add, that provides for rent subsidies. We think of all the people who were able to stay in their homes during the pandemic and after the pandemic because we subsidized their rent. Why does that not make sense and encourages builders to build these homes, build these apartments?
Para continuar al frente del gobierno estadounidense, Biden y la vicepresidenta Kamala Harris necesitan de los votantes latinos, particularmente en estados como Nevada y Arizona, lugares a los que también acompañamos al presidente Biden durante su gira de campaña y en donde, según las últimas encuestas, la carrera presidencial está sumamente cerrada. Nevada y Arizona destacan entre los estados clave para alcanzar los 270 votos del colegio electoral necesarios para ganar la presidencia. Un análisis de la organización Naleo revela que los electores latinos en Nevada y Arizona representan entre el 20 y el 25% del total de los votos que se esperan en noviembre. Y en el condado Clark, en Nevada, donde 3 de cada 10 habitantes son latinos, la falta de acceso a vivienda de bajo costo se ha convertido en una de las prioridades entre los votantes.
Mi nombre es Víctor Cureño Galeana y tengo 52 años.
Mi nombre es María Bejarano y tengo 50 años.
Yo soy del Estado de México y llegué aquí como a los 18 años.
Yo vengo de Durango, México. Yo no sabía lo que era rentar, pagar una renta, y desde que llegué aquí llegamos a trabajar porque teníamos que pagar renta. Pagamos 2,800 de renta.
Yo trabajo en una bodega descargando trailers.
Yo le dije que yo había escuchado de ese programa que tenía el presidente Biden de compradores por primera vez.
¿Y esta casa cuánto le costó?
Nos costó $155,000.
Y pues ya al movernos aquí, pagamos mucho menos. Yo nunca pensé que pudiera tener un hogar. O sea, algo que yo llamara mi casa, nunca pensé que lo pudiera tener. Entonces, ya no digo ahí donde vivo, ya digo es mi casa.
Para 2021, el 50.6% de los hogares latinos en Estados Unidos eran dueños de sus viviendas, el nivel más alto en la última década. Para la fórmula Biden-Harris, es fundamental capitalizar logros como este para recuperar el apoyo de los votantes latinos.
You know, last time, you're the reason why, in large part, I beat Donald Trump.
Yes.
Let's be together. Well, you know, I need you. I need you badly. I need the help. Kamala and I desperately need your help.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
All right. I'll behave.
You know, the road back to the White House goes through El Barrio, especially in places like Nevada and here in Arizona. What's at stake for Latino voters in this election?
I think everything is at stake. First of all, it's how they're viewed by the President of the United States. Just look at the way Trump talks about Latinos. He talks about them as Mexicans, rapists and criminals, murderers. He talks about how, I mean, it's just, look, there's not a fundamental difference in the value set between Irish Catholic neighbors I grew up and Latinos. It's about faith, it's about family, it's about togetherness, it's about having each other's back. And he doesn't share any of those notions.
Sir, you chose this company today to deliver a message on the economy. I've heard you talk about economic growth, job creation. What do you say to the families, not just Latino families, but families across the country that don't feel that economic growth, that job creation reflected in their paychecks, in their pockets?
Well, it's not yet, but guess what? The 15 million jobs that we've created so far, more than any president has in the time period, were 4.5 million are Latinos. 4.5 million more than any other time, number one. Number two, well, also it's about changing what happens at the kitchen table. For example, you know, we talk about trickle-down economy. Huh? You know, as long as the wealthy do well, it'll trickle down the rest of us. Well, nothing ever trickled down on my dad's kitchen table, okay? But guess what? When you have to pay $35 for an overdraft or a check, but guess what, I changed it to $8. If in fact you're in a situation where you have a junk fee, that if you're in a situation your credit card is overdraft,
uh-huh,
instead of paying $30, $40, $50, you have to pay $3. Point is, the thing that affects people is, my dad used to say, Joey, a job's about a lot more than a paycheck. It's about your dignity. It's about your ability to have something left at the end of the month so the family can make it. Well, these junk fees cost hundreds of bucks for people, and we're eliminating them.
You also talked about lowering the cost of insulin, which is a crucial issue for Latinos, given the high prevalence there is of diabetes.
By the way, it's gigantic. It's gigantic. I've been fighting big pharma, the pharmaceutical companies, since I was a senator. Finally beat them without any Republican help, great, I might add. And the way we did that was we said, look, for example, insulin. You know how much it costs to make that insulin? $10, T-E-N, $10.
That's a production cost.
Production cost. Packaging, everything, $12, okay?
Huh.
The guy who had the patent on Amazon, he wouldn't put a patent on it. He wanted everybody to have access to it. Charged an average $400 a month on it. What's going on here? So now they cannot charge more than $35 a month. Because why? I said, for the first time, Medicare can do exactly what, and Social Security and all these other agencies can do what the Veterans Administration does. They say, we'll buy your product, but only at this price. Well, guess what? It's $35 a eat, not $400 for insulin. And guess what? Even companies who aren't covered are now saying, we're only going to sell it for $35. It's changing people's lives. Look, you know, one of the things going on here, all kids aside, is the way we denigrate people. The way we talk about people, the way we talk about, and he was even making fun of my being an Irish Catholic. I mean, what the hell is this? It's never been like this. Never been like this. It's going to stop.
La migración siempre ha sido un tema personal para Joe Biden, quien expresa con orgullo sus raíces irlandesas. También ha sido uno de los principales retos de su presidencia. En lo que va de su administración, más de 6 millones de migrantes se han entregado a las autoridades en la frontera con México y 2.3 millones más han ingresado al país con procesos pendientes en las cortes de migración.
Immigration now. You've been criticized by Republicans for not doing enough to secure the border after months that your administration spent negotiating a border security bill that dramatically increased funding for border protections. But you've also been criticized by some Democratic advocates that said they feel disappointed because they perceive this as a departure from democratic values on immigration. My question is, how do you propose to fix what is arguably the most polarizing issue in American politics today?
Well, first of all, the first piece of legislation I introduced as president was related to the border. First one, I wanted to make sure everything from Dreamers had a path to citizenship all the way to providing for enough border security people to orderly handle the border, to allow legal immigration and prevent illegal immigration. We're in a situation where, for example, we don't have enough officers to maybe interview people to discern whether they have a legitimate fear or concern to qualify to come in. We don't have enough people at the border. We don't have enough Border Patrol people. We don't have enough machinery that we can detect fentanyl and illegal drugs coming in. It's all there. And so what happened? We worked this with a very conservative Republican from Oklahoma, the senator, came along and he ran on one side and Democrats on the other side, and they worked for 4 months. And they came up with a proposal. It didn't have everything I wanted. I told them I was going to go back and get Dreamers and et cetera. But the thing it did do, it provided for significant more personnel to make an orderly transfer and allow legal immigration to increase, not decrease, and diminish illegal immigration.
In November, my team began serious negotiations with a bipartisan group of senators. The result was a bipartisan bill with the toughest set of border security reforms we've ever seen. Oh, you don't think so? Oh, you don't like that bill, huh? That conservatives got together and said it was a good bill? I'll be darned. That's amazing. That bipartisan bill would hire 1,500 more security agents and officers, 100 more immigration judges to help tackle the backload of 2 million cases, 4,300 more asylum officers, and new policies so they can resolve cases in 6 months instead of 6 years now.
And when this is literally the truth, what happened was when Trump found out that I liked it and I supported it and I'd get, quote, credit for it, he got on the phone, not a joke, checked with the Republicans and called them and said, don't be for it, it'll benefit Biden. When the hell would you vote on a major piece of legislation based on whether you benefit somebody as in politics? It's either good or it's bad. It was a good piece of legislation, and I'm not giving up on it.
Have you made a final decision on taking executive order in terms of what you want to do at the border? That includes the power to shut down the border, as it was suggested.
Well, it suggested that. We're examining whether or not I have that power. I would have that power under the legislation when the border has over 500,000 people, 5,000 people a day trying to cross the border because you can't manage it, slow it up. There's no guarantee that I have that power all by myself without legislation. And some have suggested I should just go ahead and try it. And if I get shut down by the court, I get shut down by the court. But we're trying to work through that right now.
President López Obrador has come up with a plan to fight the root causes of migration in the Western Hemisphere. It calls for the U.S. to invest $20 billion, as well as ease sanctions on Venezuela and Cuba, among other things. Your opponent said he wouldn't give Mexico 10 cents. How would you work with President López Obrador to reduce migration and also with his successors?
Before Obrador even came up with that plan, I initiated that plan years ago. Look, it's not like people are sitting around a table, a hand-hewn table somewhere in Guatemala and saying, I got a great idea. Let's sell everything we have, give it to a criminal gang. They're going to take us across the border. They're going to drop us on the other side, where language you don't speak, where they don't want me. Won't that be fun? People don't, they leave because they have no alternatives. And so what we're doing is we did, and it was working for a while till they cut it off, is provide for the ability to have jobs created in the countries where people are leaving. People don't want to leave where we're from. People want to be able to make sure that they have an opportunity to just make a living. And they'd rather make a living where they are. And so I think his idea is consistent with what I've been pushing. And I think we should be doing something like that.
You have a good relationship with President López Obrador.
I do. I find him straightforward. He's never kidded me. He knows what he wants. He keeps his word. That's about as much as I can ask.
Now that we're talking about world leaders, in the past few days, we've seen increasing protests in Israel calling for the removal of Prime Minister Netanyahu and international condemnation after the death of World Central Kitchen aid workers during an Israeli airstrike. Do you think at this point Prime Minister Netanyahu is more concerned about his political survival than he is in the national interest of his people?
What I will tell you is I think what he's doing is a mistake. I don't agree with his approach. I think it's outrageous that those three vehicles were hit by drones and taken out on a highway where it wasn't like it was along the shore. It wasn't like there was a convoy moving here, et cetera. So what I'm calling for is for the Israelis to just call for a ceasefire, allow for the next 6-8 weeks total access to all food and medicine going into the country. I've spoken with everyone from the Saudis to the Jordanians to the Egyptians. They're prepared to move in. They're prepared to move this food in. And I think there's no excuse to not provide for the medical and the food needs of those people. They should be done now.
Are you any closer to a deal with Republicans about a fresh round of military aid to Kyiv and to Ukraine?
Well, the vast majority of Republicans agree with me, as you know. If we had a vote tomorrow, if the new Speaker of the House of Representatives had the guts to call for a vote, and on Ukraine, it would pass overwhelmingly. And the majority of Republicans in both House and Senate would vote for it. So this is a very dangerous thing that's going on now. We're in a circumstance where we have we've done something that I was very proud of. I've been engaged with NATO my whole career. We were able to expand NATO, and we have to thousands of miles of border because you have two Nordic nations having joined NATO. You have a whole range of NATO countries along the Russian border. Mm-hmm. And the Russians have lost and or have wounded over 300,000 personnel trying to take somebody else's property and land. And it's just cruel and unusual punishment. And so if we don't step up and provide the help we need, I was able to find another $310 million available that hadn't been used yet. But I've run out of runway to provide for more aid without the aid of the Congress. And so I'm hoping that the Speaker of the House begins to have the courage to do what I'm confident he knows what has to be done. But I think he's worried about losing the speakership because of a strange the House Republican. Look, this is not your father's Republican Party, as that old saying goes. This is a different breed of cat. This is Trump runs that party. He maintains a sort of a death grip on it. Everybody's afraid to take him on, whether they agree with him or not. And it's incredibly dangerous. The last thing we need is to see NATO start to break apart. It'd be a disaster for the United States, disaster for Europe, disaster for the world.
The White House today shares some very important.
Las decisiones sobre el futuro de la OTAN y la seguridad colectiva de Europa se toman en este lugar.
Thank you so much.
Welcome back to the White House.
Thank you so much.
Desde principios del siglo pasado, la oficina Oval ha sido el lugar en el que despachan todos los presidentes estadounidenses y en la que cada mandatario incluye a personajes y momentos históricos que han inspirado su carrera política. En el caso de Joe Biden, esto incluye las imágenes de George Washington, Abraham Lincoln y Franklin Delano Roosevelt, además de los bustos de Martin Luther King, Rosa Parks y César Chávez.
I know you have the César Chávez bust, which I wanted to ask you about.
There it is. You know, when I was a young senator, I was actually running for office, and I was 29 years old, and Delaware's largest industry is agriculture, and he was organizing farm workers in my state, and I supported him, which was very controversial at the time in the southern part of my state, and so I always admired him because he was all about fairness and decency. I mean, he really was about just, we talked about values, basic values.
Family values.
Family values, you know, faith, family, things that matter. Turns out that the woman running my campaign is his granddaughter.
Julie Chavez.
Julie Chavez.
We spoke to her in Phoenix.
Yeah. I mean, isn't that amazing? I didn't even know that. Want to come over here and stand
sure,
by?
Sure, I appreciate that.
And, but it was amazing that, and I was very, it was, it cost me some votes in those days, probably. But I was really proud. I was really proud. I didn't know him personally, so I don't want to exaggerate my relationship with him, but he had a profound impact on basic justice and fairness. They were putting people in what used to be old slave quarters. I mean, it was stuff that were...
Right.
And, but he changed it, so...
And you talk a lot about family values. We spoke about that in Phoenix. You talk a lot about that in your book. Have you had a chance to talk to your family about a second term? And
you know, they all feel basically like the first time, and I was on the train to get a phone call, and he said, "I want to do a background check on you." I said, "I don't want to be vice president."
He didn't want to do it.
No, he said, I said, "I can help you more as being your Senate person." Huh. Rock, I said, "Well, there's only you, damn it." And I said,
"It's hard to say no to that."
I had no idea. I said, "I don't want to." I said, "Well, do me a favor, go home and talk about over your parents. We're over there with your family, and you're the family." So this is the night we became president and vice president, okay?
That's Chicago?
This is in Chicago. Mm-hmm. But so my mother called me when I, in June of the year, he became the nominee for president. Mm-hmm. And said, "What's he like?" And I said, "He's a hell of a guy. He's smart as hell. He has great integrity, etc." So the last person that I asked what I thought I should do was my mother. She was sitting on the railing on the porch. I said, "Honey, what do you think?" She said, "Joey, let me get this straight. The first African American has a chance to be president. You told him no?" I said, "Oh, so." Maybe that changed it all. But that was my mom. And look at the look in his face. My mother wasn't even supposed to go out. They were introducing now the next president, vice president. My mother goes to him, "Come on, honey, it's going to be okay." Look at his face.
That's amazing. That's an amazing picture.
It is my favorite.
Let me say it as simply as I can. Yes. Yes, I accept your nomination to run and serve with Barack Obama, the next president of the United States of America.
Do you think a lot about legacy? Because we're talking about over 50 years of public service. And regardless of the outcome, this might be your last political campaign. You've done a few. Did you spend a lot of time thinking about what your legacy would look like?
Well, I hope the legacy is that I kept my word, that I said that the reason I was running was to help change the life of ordinary people and reduce the prospect of war and because of Vietnam. And when I ran, I said that I was once asked, "Well, why would, when I was one of 29 years old, I said, it must be a secret." And I said, "Yeah, the secret you got to ask yourself is, what are you willing to lose over? If you figure out what you're willing to lose over, you got an idea of what you should be doing." Mm. And so I hope my legacy is that I was honest, straightforward, and did what I said.
Gracias por acompañarnos en este programa especial y la entrevista exclusiva con el presidente Joe Biden. Yo soy Enrique Acevedo y a nombre de todos mis compañeros le deseo que tenga buenas noches y buena suerte.